Welcome and Merry Christmas. Welcome as we celebrate light in a dark year. Nearly 3,000 years ago, God made this promise to a people weighed down by life's burdens, a promise that speaks to us this year in 2020. God said through Isaiah, "Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who are in distress. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. God promised that 3,000 years ago, and 2,000 years ago, God kept that promise. We celebrate now because Jesus came. He came as light in a dark world, and so we pray. O God, who makes us glad with the yearly remembrance of the birth of your only Son, Jesus Christ, grant that as we joyfully receive him for our Redeemer, so may we with sure confidence behold him who shall come to be our Judge, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, world without end. Amen. We sing in celebration. We come, we gather. O come, all ye faithful, come and adore him, light in the dark world.
To bear.
We come in adoration, praying, Almighty God, you have given us your only Son to take our nature upon him and as at this time to be born of a pure virgin. Grant that we, being born again, made your children by adoption and grace, may daily be renewed by your Holy Spirit through our Lord Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. God has come to be with us, to be one of us. Do watch this clip and reflect on the wonder of Christmas.
On that first Christmas, Mary met God's messenger, who brought news of great joy.
You're having a baby boy!
On that first Christmas, Joseph was in meltdown. All his plans were wrecked. He was feeling super stressed. He was just about to snap.
Oh dear, looks like he has.
His wife-to-be is up the duff. The child's not his. It's all too much. When word gets out, there'll be such drama. So, chopping wood helps him feel calmer. Joseph plans to walk away. What on earth would make him stay? He heads off to hit the hay. And as he sleeps, God speaks.
Joseph, don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife. The baby in her is from the Holy Spirit.
Good news for a heart that was filled with fear. Good news of Emmanuel. God, come near.
She will have a son, and they will name him Emmanuel. This name means God is with us.
Joseph got up, and Joseph went on. Together they witnessed the birth of God's Son.
God's with us,
they whispered while holding him tight. He's come into our chaos and into our night. For those now in meltdown whose plans have been wrecked. For all who are feeling tired and stressed. For anyone who's ready to snap and everyone that's in a flap. This is the good news we all need to hear. God is with us, right now, and right here. This Christmas time, please don't walk away. For God is with us, and he came to stay. We can get up, and we can go on, held tight by our Saviour, Jesus, God's Son.
Emmanuel. His name means God is with us.
Hey, I'm James, and I usually go to the 3 p.m. service at Portland. I've been asked to tell you about what Christmas means to me before I lead in prayer. So for me, Christmas is all about the gifts. I like receiving gifts. I like giving gifts. I like to give really practical gifts, things that people usually wouldn't buy themselves. I've got a family of six, brothers and sisters, and so we do a secret Santa for Christmas. So I only buy presents for one of them each year. A couple of years ago, I got my brother, and as I said, I like to get practical gifts. So I got him a really nice, good quality pair of earmuffs. Yep. And he uses them. As I said, Christmas is about the gifts to me. And I'm always reminded of the gift of Jesus. So God give us the gift of Jesus to save us from our sins. And we need to accept the gift and we also need to use it. So just like these earmuffs that I got my brother, He needed to accept the gift, but he also needed to use it. Otherwise, he'd suffer things like hearing loss, and you know, it just wouldn't be good, pointless. So my hope for you guys is that you accept the gift of Jesus and use it. I'm going to lead us in prayer now. So let's just go for it. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given. The government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Father God, you are creator and sustainer of all. You placed every star in the sky, and you made the individual planets orbit those stars. You are Mighty God. Lord, you have ultimate power over those stars and the cosmos, to the point that you directed man to your Son, yourself, Jesus, way down in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. Thank you that you are still active, directing us not through stars and angels, but through your word, the Bible, each other and the Holy Spirit toward yourself through Jesus. He is the only way to be completely satisfied on this earth, and the only way to eternal life. You are the Wonderful Counselor. Lord, help us to continue to turn from our selfish desires and turn to you and follow your plans for our lives. Your plan is for us to choose you in every aspect of our lives. You promise if we do this, you will bless us and sustain us with everything we need. Lord, unfortunately, we live in a sinful world where our heart's desires are not what you planned. We continue to make decisions that don't follow your word, the Bible. We continue to put other things before you. Lord, help us to be blessed by the wonderful gifts you give us. Help us to not put things of this world before you, but to put you above all in our lives. God, we have had a sad and long year, with fires and COVID and governments playing dangerous games without thought of the little people they affect. We truly live in a fallen world. As sickness, environmental destruction, and governmental control cause us to feel helpless, Lord, bring us the joy and the peace that only comes from you. You are the Prince of Peace. Bring joy and peace to the earth and to our hearts. Help us to remember you are supreme in all. You are the creator, the sustainer of everything. You alone control the environment. You alone control our health. And you alone control the powers of this world. God, you alone hold back the tidal wave. Lord, we now pray that you hold back the tidal wave. Please give us more time. Time to grow closer to you, and time to spread the great news of how good it is to know, serve, and trust you, God. Thank you, God, for how you have protected us. You protected us from mass destruction in the fires. You protect us now from COVID, and you guide our leaders as they make decisions according to your plan. Thank you that you spare us. Thank you that you bless us. As we think of giving and receiving gifts this Christmas, let us remember that every good gift is from you, and only perfect gifts, gifts that don't spoil or fade, are from you, the ultimate and loving God. Lord, continue to guide our lives, our thoughts, and our actions. Bring us to you. Help us to trust you, the everlasting God, and give us your guidance for our lives. Lord, bless us. Bless the Prime Minister, Scott Morrison. Bless the Queen Elizabeth and her descendants. And Lord, please bless your holy church. Guide us all to more love in you. Thanks in advance. Amen.
Brightly shining, it is the night of of our dear Saviour's birth. Long lay the world in sin and error pining, till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill divine, oh, now.
So I've been asked to share a little bit about what Christmas means to me before I go into our New Testament reading. So Christmas to me is a bit of a twofold meaning, I guess, because there's the immediate response of, oh, it's holidays, which I think everyone needs to this year. And also, like, there's, I have all my family coming over, so it's a joyous time of love and fun. There's also a little bit of anxiety in there because I have a big family, lots of loudness. It's always very busy and something's going on. So that's sort of one side of the meaning of Christmas for me, the immediate meaning. But then there's also this spiritual long-term meaning for me, which is that Jesus came. It's kind of the real big meaning of Christmas, that Jesus came to earth in this baby form, which is ludicrous, really, the fact that the all-powerful creator of the world would submit himself to being cared for and nurtured by a human is crazy. And I think one of my favorite carols is Mary, Did You Know? And I think that really points out how crazy it is that this person who is also God came down, is in this baby form being nurtured by a human, but is then going to go on to save the world, is just ridiculous. But, like, what else could it be? That makes complete sense as well. Yeah. So we're going to move on from that and go into Luke chapter 2, verses 21 to 40. So we're going to be hearing about what happens after Jesus is born. Here we go. So Luke chapter 2, verse 21. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise the child, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he was conceived. When the time came for the purification rites required by the law of Moses, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer the sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child, Jesus, to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel." The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." Then there was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Penuel of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then was a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, and he was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was on him.
Lights are one of the great Christmas traditions. The tradition of, you know, lights on trees and candles on your windowsills They make sense in the European starting place where Christmas follows after the shortest day of the year, but for us here in Australia, our long summer days don't stop us embracing light at Christmas. We like to capture the joy, the fun, the celebration light brings. Now, my street, house after house, has been lit up this month with an array of red and blue and white, yellow lights. It's across the roofs, it's down in the front. There are actually others drive down our streets to admire what is going on in our place. In our home, tiny fairy lights line the roof, the doors. They thread through the Christmas tree. Lights are a great Christmas tradition, not just because they're decorative and pretty. Light's symbolic. In the Bible, light is life and goodness. Light is truth. Light is knowledge. It's why we want the light. Darkness is death. Darkness is evil. Darkness is ignorance and lies. It's sometimes why we hide in the dark. Now, 2020 will go down as a hard year. It'll go down as a dark year. But this year, we need light in our darkness. And thankfully, light is exactly what God provides at Christmas. You know, the best reason for lavish light displays at Christmas is that they remind us exactly who Jesus is. Jesus is true light for all. Jesus is true light for all. Did you notice what Simeon said when he cradled the baby Jesus? My eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and glory for your people Israel. Jesus is true light for all. And after a dark year, God wants to shed fresh light on you. Simeon prayed to God contentedly after he'd seen Jesus. He prayed, Lord, dismiss me in peace. Dismiss your servant in peace. Two things rob us of peace. The world is not as good as it should be, and I'm not as good as I'd like to be. But not even those two dark realities could rob Simeon's peace when he had seen Jesus. A light had shone in him that not even death's darkness could dim. And God wants you to have that same peace. He wants to shine a light on you by seeing Jesus clearly. Perhaps for the first time ever. See, as you see the trees and houses lit up today, tomorrow, remember this, Jesus is true light for all. Two parts of this truth. The first, Jesus is light in our dark world. Christ came to end evil and ignorance. So the incident Emily read is a week after Jesus' birth. He's 8 days old. The scene reminds us that Jesus came into our dark world. He entered a world disconnected from God. Mary and Joseph, they trek 13 kilometers with a newborn to make a series of sacrifices at the temple, sacrifices of purification, a reminder that all people, even infants, newborns, are disconnected from God by our failure to love perfectly. We're so disconnected that something has to be paid, a sacrifice made that we would be acceptable to Him. And Jesus enters as well a world of injustice, a dark world, as one poor and oppressed. Joseph and Mary's offering, the one they bring of two birds, was made only by the poorest. And Jesus entered a world of aging and loss, our dark world. That the prophet Anna, at the end, she is described bluntly. She was very old, and she had been long time widowed, a long time alone. See, Jesus wasn't born into a fairy tale world. He was born into our dark reality, a world of COVID fear and empty chairs at Christmas lunch. A world of poverty, injustice, and ignorance of God, and some of it willful ignorance. A world where our failure to love God and others as much as we love ourselves means we are disconnected from God, disconnected from others, the world's disrupted. And God looks and he sees our problem and he steps in, he joins us. Jesus is light into a dark world. He came to end evil and ignorance. The Holy Spirit, notice how he moves Simeon. He moves Simeon not just to see a child, but to see who this child is. Simeon holds Jesus in his arms, treasures him like a gift, and praises God. Simeon sees Jesus clearly. The light has been switched on. He sees Jesus and says, "This is salvation." He sees Jesus is going to overcome the darkness of this world that robs us of peace. Jesus will overcome the poverty, the sickness, the sin within, and even death. Jesus will open perfection to all who trust him, bring us into light. And Simeon sees, therefore, Jesus is light for Gentiles. Gentiles, that's all who aren't Jewish. All who traditionally have no relationship with God. And Jesus' light for revelation, he reveals, that is, he shows exactly who God is. It's like he's a spotlight on Jesus, on God. You know, you want to study the character of God? Well, you study Jesus. You want to see why God can be trusted even when he asks you to do what you don't like and leads you to a place you don't want to go? Well, then study Jesus, get to know him. He's the spotlight on God. He's the revelation. The only way to truly know God is by looking at the light, looking at Jesus. He overcomes our ignorance of God so that anyone and everyone can experience his salvation, to get out of the darkness. Jesus is light in a dark world. He has come to end evil and ignorance. He's come to comfort and console in verse 25. He's come to bring peace to people like Simeon, to people who live under death's shadow, to people like us in 2020. Now, this light costs. A dark cloud hangs over the light. Rembrandt's painting, The Holy Family, captures the early months of Jesus' family life. I'm no art expert, but in the foreground, you might be able to see all is calm and peaceful. Mary's there, she's doting over this little baby. Could be any loving mother with her child. But you look in the background, and the background says there's way more going on. This is no ordinary child. In the background, angels are descending. That is, God is actively breaking into the normal pattern of this world. There's something going on. And as well, Joseph, he's in there in the background. He's not doting, he's carving away. He's doing his work. He's making a yoke. Now, I'm no art expert, but critics point out that the yoke symbolically looks ahead to the burdens Jesus will carry for us. Some critics suggest Joseph might even be carving a cross. A cloud hangs over the light. And that's Simeon's words to Mary. Simeon's words to his mother, what's ahead? Mary's soul will be pierced. So Jesus was brought to Jerusalem for sacrifices as a baby. But later, as a man, Jesus chose to return to Jerusalem to be the sacrifice. Mary would grieve one day for her son who would be pierced and nailed to the cross, and on that day, darkness would cover the land even as her soul was pierced. The light of the world would take all the darkness that robs you and me of peace to bring salvation instead, to destroy darkness forever. Our British author Dorothy Sayers puts it, "The incarnation means that for whatever reason God chose to let us fall, suffer, and be subject to sorrow and death, he nonetheless has the honesty and courage to take his own medicine. He can exact nothing from man that he has not exacted from himself. He himself has gone through the whole human experience, from the trivial irritations of family life and the cramping restriction of hard work and the lack of money to the worst horrors of pain and humiliation, defeat, despair, and death. He was born in poverty and suffered infinite pain all for us and thought it well worth his while." That's the killer line. He suffered infinite pain all for us and thought it well worth his while. So as you see, you look around, you'll see the Christmas lights, you'll see them on your tree, you'll see them in the houses around you. Remember, Jesus is true light for all. That's what it points to. He has suffered darkness to take it from you. And he thought you worth his while. He is the light you need in this dark year. Whatever struggle you are going through this Christmas as you look at our broken world, know that Christ has come. He knows your hurts and he has overcome them. One day he will come again and all that darkness will be gone along with the terrifying self-interest that caused it. Secondly, Jesus lights your heart. Christ reveals if you're still in the dark. So the lights on my Christmas tree don't just highlight the tree. They do a great job of lighting up the tree. I see the tree really well. But they also reveal everything in the room. You know, in ours, we can read a book by the light of the Christmas tree. You can see everyone who's in the room. There's no hiding. Jesus doesn't just provide light for us to see who God is. He exposes us. Simeon explains it in verse 34, that Jesus will cause the rising and falling of many, and that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, your inner self shown. Jesus coming says who he is, yes, salvation and light and glory. He also says who you are, whether you've entered the light or still in the darkness, where your heart is. And the key to knowing whether you will rise eternally or whether you will fall eternally is how Jesus impacts you. So as you look at Christmas lights today, I want you to give yourself a three-point check. A three-point check. Three signs to check you've really seen Jesus. Contentment, longing, and gratitude. First, contentment. That you've peace in the darkest moments. Simeon is ready to be dismissed in peace because his eyes saw Jesus. He is ready to die and face God with confidence. He's also ready to live with confidence. J.C. Ryle puts it, he speaks as one for whom the grave has lost its terror and the world lost its charms. Simeon has seen the salvation Jesus brings. It has lifted a burden from him, a burden about his own failures, his own need to prove himself to God and to others, to himself. He has peace. You know, so many people are weary this year, and it's not just because of COVID. There is the continual burden of meeting expectations, of justifying yourself. You know, working hard to prove that you deserve a good life, that you deserve eternal blessing, doing that, that's tiring. You know, pleasing others because you need their approval, that's wearying. Doing good to earn God's approval, that will grind you down. You'll never get peace is robbed. But those who see Jesus clearly, look at him, lean on him, trust in him, the burden is removed. They live content with nothing to prove. It is the difference between a religious person and a Christian. A religious person is someone who's trying to save themselves through their good works. And they never have peace of mind because they never know if they're good enough. A Christian is somebody who sees themselves in God's debt, secure because he's already given them so much. Leaning on a grace and a present. Simeon is not a religious person. Simeon is content because he stopped trying and he's just received. And the sign that you have seen Jesus, that you will rise, that the light has shone in your heart, is you're content. You've peace in the darkest moments. Second check, longing. There is nothing in this world that you want more than Christ. See, God promised Simeon that he would live to see comfort, consolation for a dark world. That he would live to see the Saviour. And so Simeon spent his days, he lived waiting for Jesus. His eyes were fixed there. That was his focus, his desire. He was a righteous and devout man in verse 25, but he wasn't consumed by his reputation, his standing in the community. He wasn't self-obsessed with his goodness. No, his greatest desire was to see God himself. You know, Ryle's word again, he speaks as one for whom the grave has lost its terror and the world its charms. Anna's the same. She lost her husband young. Some of you know that kind of grief. She's seemingly left childless. She spends the next 84 years worshipping day and night. She is not consumed by her grief and loss. Her great desire is to be in God's presence. Leo Tolstoy, at 50, he had money, he had fame, he had just finished the novel Anna Karenina, a recognized classic that has crossed from Russian to English. And you know, his writing, his work has given him a form of immortality. But with all that success, what did he write? He wrote this. The very simple question that lies in the soul of every human being is this. Why should I live? Why should I wish for anything? Is there any meaning in my life that wouldn't be destroyed by death? So Simeon and Anna had an answer for Tolstoy's question. They found an answer for the question in every soul. They found eternal meaning. And so they longed for Christ. They wanted to see him because it's in him is meaning. They wanted to be in his presence, and nothing in this world mattered more. The sign that you have seen Jesus, that you will rise, that the light has shone in your heart, is you long. You want to be with Jesus. You want to be with his people. You pray for him to come again. And there is no joy in this life, no grief in this life that matters more than him. And the third check, the third sign, gratitude. Your thankfulness spills over. See, Anna, she sees this child. She gives thanks to God and she speaks about the child to everyone around her. See, true gratitude can never be kept to yourself. G.K. Chesterton put it, the worst moment for an atheist is when he's really thankful and has no one to thank. So when you've received something great, you can't help but express it. You've got to let others know. Anna is not commanded. No one tells her to tell others about Jesus. You know, the baby Jesus doesn't say a thing to her. She can't stop, though. Jesus is that good that the struggles of age, the struggle of loneliness fade into thanks. Jesus is that good, she wants others to have him too, to see him as well. A woman was constantly buying her son Bibles. Time after time, he'd phone her for another. Because he'd keep getting in conversations about Jesus and he'd give his copy away. So she'd buy him two at a time and both would go. Now this is impractical, but he loved being sent them, a reminder that knowing God was a gift to be shared. Gratitude spills. And the sign that you've seen Jesus, that you will rise, not fall, that the light has shone in your heart, is your gratitude for Jesus spills over. If you aren't content, if you aren't longing, if you aren't grateful, be honest. What has Jesus exposed in your heart this Christmas? See, lights are a great Christmas tradition. Light is what we need. It's life. And in this dark year, as you look at those lights, remember, Jesus is true light for all. Let me pray. Our Lord and Father, we thank you so much for Jesus, for you coming into our world, becoming one of us, that you might overcome the darkness within us, the darkness outside that we experience, that you will bring us one day into perfection if all we do is receive that gift. And so, Father, may we rejoice in that gift today. May we long for Jesus' return, and may we find the peace that he brings today and live in peace now and always. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Creature of God, come bless his name.
Christmas Day.
Jesus is light in a dark year, the light of the world, light for the world, the reason for Christmas Day, the reason for all our celebrations in life. If you'd like to spend more time knowing Jesus and knowing all he's done, there are a number of ways to do it. We have formal courses with others, or you could come to church in person, or you could simply read the rest of Luke's gospel with a Christian that you trust. A great first step. He's contacting me. But may the rest of your celebrations be joyous. And before we close in our final carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, join with me once more in prayer, and after which have a wonderful celebration of Christmas. We pray. Loving Father, who sent your only Son into the world, that we might have life through faith in him, grant that we who celebrate his birth may come at last to the fullness of life in your heavenly kingdom, where he now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Enjoy the celebrations and let us sing Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
See you. angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive the King. I know that love has come, sing it out, Jesus Christ is born, Jesus Christ is born, yeah, yeah. Jesus Christ is born. I hear the angels singing, hallelujah, let the earth receive the King. I know that love has come. Sing it out, Jesus Christ is born.
King is sleeping, oh what a glorious night, oh what a glorious night.